On heat pipes, this is a big thing too, because everybody wants to repaste their laptops. I don't recommend unless you're, you know, you don't care about your warranty. First question is liquid metal, because definitely vendors are pushing, hey, we got liquid metal now. I've had a couple of vendors. There's three laptops that I know of that are being sold with it. Advantages of liquid metal, disadvantage, are there any big disadvantages? And what do you think about this whole sort of like, I just need to repaste my laptop, which is take apart the heat spreader and put.
I'll answer the second question first. I believe that culture is because of the lack of understanding on the TJ response due to the dynamic power. So everybody sees 100 and they immediately want to go undervolt, right? They'll pull in Intel to the XTU and they're undervolt the part. So yes, you can do that and it'll cut power significantly. Then they repaste it. And then you'll typically see some logs online saying, hey, I cut my temperature by 12 degrees. Yeah, but you're running at a lower voltage. So you've got risk to basically soft bit errors if you do that. Behavior is historic change in power limits. Because if you look at history, right, if you go to Haswell, turbo was only 19 watts for a 15 watt part, right? So if you go back to that generation, to this generation, you're seeing, you know, 50 to 60 watts. So yeah. Within 22, 14, 10, that transition and scale, basically that power has quadrupled. And so that's what you're seeing is the response to. Now, the liquid metal, I think there's pluses and minuses. I am absolutely terrified of it, to be honest, because I think there's a way to do it, but I haven't seen a good way where it's completed yet. And here are the risks. Basically, with aluminum, it oxidizes. So if you have any type of aluminum structure, either an auger type feeder from our suppliers to actually apply the material, or if you have it come in contact with aluminum, it basically breaks the grain boundary of the aluminum and causes it to oxidize. So that material immediately impacts your design. If you have the presence of water vapor, you can create hydrogen gas. So basically, if water vapor plus the aluminum gets into play, it outgasses. From that aspect as well. That's the second key factor. So humidity is an impact. So those two are key. The third is serviceability. So if you go try to remove the material, it's extremely electrically conductive. If you don't manage it correctly and you get it on your motherboard, you will short out whatever component it comes in contact with. And most of our suppliers that we see in customers, they're going to take a paper towel and try to wipe it off. And if you wipe the material off, the surface tension causes it to roll. And it wants to roll off the side of the CPU die down onto the motherboard. So that typically has been the first three key constraints. The fourth constraint is basically material fillers. If you ship it at cold temps, it wants to solidify and it creates voids. And so if, from Dell's perspective, we ship a lot of product around the world. If I airship anything and it goes to sub-freezing temperatures, you create potential regions for basically separation of the material. You create voids. So that's why I think it's critical to do it right. I haven't seen it yet. We are tracking this. Obviously, I told you, maybe not on this call, but I manage Dell's technology roadmap. We are razor focused on it. There is potential there as far as conductivity and what we call heat capacity, but it has to be done right, or you're going to risk potentially long-term reliability issues.
Sure. There's no doubt that it is better. But
oh, absolutely.
The risks are the issues, those risks of blowing up your laptop.
Yeah. So we use a material called 7921 from Shinetsu. We've got Dow grease as well. It's actually pretty good. So if you look at Arctic Silver, we've done some recent testing, and I know that's what everybody usually replaced our stuff with. The 7921 from our data shows that we're better. And so there's no reason to repaste your solution on an Alienware or Inspiron. With Arctic Silver. You could go look in doing it with the gallium, liquid gallium. My feedback to you for the DIY guy, take your time. Ensure you get it at the center of the die. Make sure you apply the heat sink appropriately. Make sure you don't let any of that material come out. Yes, you will see probably a 5 to 6 degree drop in temperature based upon the conductivity and capacity, but the risk is you got to do it right from that approach.
All right, just wondering. So, thermal paste is what everybody calls it, but you know, the stuff between the die and the heat pipe, is that applied at the factory? I don't know if you can answer this. Is that applied typically by hand or is that machine based? Because I kind of do wonder if there's sometimes you get that worker that's still eating their taco and they don't. That would be me. I'd be like, wow, oh, I didn't do that one right, you know?
No,
we're got fired from Ford, so no.
We're fully automated, right? So the old school days of screen printing, that was a long time ago, at least on mobile. If you look at our approach, everybody is trying to go automation. So that's a worldwide trend. They are trying to ensure quality. And we talked about this a little bit. So if you take liquid metal, I don't know if you're familiar with an auger is, but basically imagine this.
Please explain it.
It's like a corkscrew. So if you look at a corkscrew for a wine bottle, that's metal. That's usually how they want to actually, they call it an auger application of the material onto, say, the die or the heat sink. So you pull the board over, you get this auger that screws it. With liquid metal, if anything is aluminum, if it comes into contact with any of that material, it basically ruins the material. And so it becomes critical that you apply it. So you can do it with pressure or other methods to go do that. But in most cases, we are fully automated from our process.
And I'm asking that because a lot of the comments I see from people, they'll say like, you know, Gordon must have built my laptop because they did a lousy job on the paste job. I got to repaste it. And then there was, and I don't know if it's real or just fish stories, because it's always like, well, I went from 99C down to, you know, 25C after I did my repaste, right?
So usually what you'll see in that data set, they also undervolted. So if you undervolt, the relationship between power and voltage is a V squared term, right? So if you go from 1.1 volts to 0.1, that's 10%, it's 10% squared. And so that's the reduction in power. So most of the cases you'll see that they'll go in, they'll use an application such as Intel XTU, they're undervolt and they'll change the grease. Now that's not saying per se that, you know, we ship 14 million Latitude units a year plus, you know, can you have excursions? Absolutely. When you're doing that type of volume, but typically we're pretty rock solid. Our quality organization is very good. We have basically what we call critical parameters. It's called CPK, critical performance parameters that we track at the factory to look at that. In most cases, they should be pretty good. Now, what could happen and has happened in the past, it gets really challenging when you're touching off, say, CPU, GPU, memory of the GPU, FETs, voltage regulator of both, and you've got all these touch points. So if that heatsink is not within spec, or if you have it shipped from a factory, and let's say an operator grabs it the wrong way and it bends, now when I apply it, I have it, we'll call it caulking, but I don't have full flatness. That absolutely can be a key challenge, and it's one that we take very seriously in looking at our designs and our callouts of our critical parameters with our partners.
I almost wonder if people should be, you know, torquing the actual heat pipes down when they're, you know, I imagine most people just do it by hand, but I almost wonder if you're doing a repaste, you should torque it to using a, you know, a torque wrench.
Micro torque wrench. That's fantastic. That's the recommendation. Obviously if you're working on your car as a DIY, you can do what you want. Right. But from a warranty perspective, typically they should torque it to the right torque, because that is critical, because usually the die, if you take a low end part, it's like 10 pound force. If you take a larger part, it's like 25. So it is important how much pressure you put on the die to make sure that that heat sink conforms. Because if you look at the die surface, so it's not flat. So everybody looks at it, it looks flat. It can be concave, it can be convex, right? So if I put a heat sink on there, that's concave as well, right? You could have the worst case where it looks like this, or you could have a case where it looks like this. And so it's really what they call post surface mount technology. So post SMT is really critical on, hey, do we have the right flatness of the die? Do we have the right flatness of the heatsink when you apply that pressure and make sure it's evenly distributed when you screw it down?
Right. I mean, we're talking probably sub-millimeter differences, enough to really kind of throw performance out of whack.
It can. And that's why if you look at our tolerances, in most cases, when we do our testing, we look at the bounds. We will have the low tolerance, the high tolerance, and we'll ensure that we're within spec with both cases. In most cases, I know the old school grease, right? We had something called 7783D. It was a little less than Arctic Silver. So that's why you probably saw that benefit. But last generation, we went to 7921, which is much better. And so I would not expect that you would see a benefit of repasting with Arctic Silver, for example, or any other high conductivity grease versus the 7921 we ship with the system.
So I do want to ask, so like if I'm the average person on the internet and I repaste my laptop, we're not saying Dell or anybody specifically, just generally, I repaste my laptop.
Yep.
Now my temps are, have gone from, you know, 99C down to, you know, 92C or 93C. Should I really expect more performance out of that? Or, I mean, I have increased the thermal headroom, but so I should still get some performance benefit, I guess?
Only if you're thermally limited. So if you were at 100C, for example, and you were throttling. So the best way to look at this, now this is, I mean, this is all independent. I'm not condoning this or any
aspect. Sure, no. No, I don't either. I like warranties. So
assuming someone's doing it on their own, they can go look at frequency. And if they looked at rated frequency of the CPU, and if they saw a drop in turbo when they were at 100, yes, they would see a benefit by getting lower temperatures. You can also do that with performance mode. So this is one thing I really want to push hard, because I don't think most of our customers understand this. With this generation of commercial products, we have moved this into BIOS. So all a customer has to do is hit the BIOS. I think it's F12, F2. I can't remember which key. I always get them confused. Basically, if they go into BIOS, they look at the feature set under power. They're going to have these four modes. If that customer places the system in performance mode, they get an increase in fan speed. They also get an increase in power limits. So yes, it's going to be slightly louder. They're going to get a little bit higher T-skins, but they are going to get significantly better performance with this generation of product. If the customer doesn't like that, let's say it's an admin, right? Somebody at the front desk, and they're just logging people in and out, or an executive going to a meeting and they're making large decisions and they don't want the noise, they can place the system in quiet mode and it'll cut acoustics 30%. And so we have been razor focused to give our customers options, because what we found, customer preference is different, right? We're hitting the fat part of the bat with our base spec, but we want to give them that flexibility to basically go in and tune it for whatever they need. And this was a big one for our commercial products with our Comet Lake launch for this year.
Why do it in the BIOS rather than from the OS?
You can do both. And we do. So basically Dell Power Manager, usually for a corporate customer, they don't want to actually load the additional software. So they want a clean image. They take their base image, wipe everything. This gives them the capability to script it. So they can basically write a script to do whatever policy they want. So very, very useful for our corporate customers. Consumer customers, you have that capability with Command Center and all our existing features today. You can do it from the OS as well.